Brahms's Second Symphony was composed in the summer of 1877, just a year after his first, and the contrast between the two is immediately clear. Brahms's first took about 2 decades of soul-searching. His second was written in the summer holidays. Where Brahms's first was epic, heavy, and intense, Brahms's second is lighter at times, and more bittersweet and personal at others. All in all, a more gentle symphony, though still on a large scale. It was written in the lakeside village of Purchach, which might have influenced the mood of the piece. It was largely well received at the time. Listeners began to call it Brahms's Pastoral Symphony, a name which never really caught on. However, several critics accused it of having no melody, which nowadays seems absolutely absurd, because its melodies are strong enough to make a grown man weep. What you'll notice is that musically, Brahms seems to be interested in developing his themes as if they were variations. Often, the themes will remain the same deep down, but on the surface level, they'll be completely varied. Tempo, orchestration, time signature, harmony will change, and yet the theme is still there in its essence. You'll see what I mean soon. The first movement is in sonata form. It begins quietly with a broad theme for horns and woodwind, punctuated by a very important 4-note figure in the basses. This mysterious beginning soon becomes a wonderful first theme, as if mystery is giving way to daylight. Then that 4-note figure is developed vigorously. But it leads to a playful transition sequence, which is actually motivically based on earlier ideas. And after this changes key, we reach the wonderful second subject melody in F sharp minor. This bears wonderful, sad resemblance to Brahms's famous lullaby. But in this symphony, that lullaby has become this. After this, energy stirs and tension builds. We get that same melody in major with a lovely accompaniment for flute. And this leads to a wind down of the exposition. The development takes a 3-note figure from the first subject and expands it into long phrases, searching through keys. And so on. This figure is treated in fugue with several counter subjects. Again, tension builds through great key changes. We keep hearing hints of that introduction theme returning, but it never quite breaks through. Finally, incredible tension builds on that theme of the introduction, as if we are leading to a grand climax. However, magically, right at the peak, we are suddenly left with very quiet trumpets and horns. All the tension suddenly lifts to reveal to us a gentler retransition. And this takes us back to the proper recapitulation. And you might notice that the trombones have that four-note figure greatly augmented. You can see how the introduction theme is now combined with the first subject theme, and that the following phrase has become richly chromatic. Once we transition to the second subject, the recapitulation is largely regular, but with completely different scoring and accompaniment. For example, the second subject lullaby, now in B minor, is scored quite differently. The coda is then filled with some extraordinary key changes based on all this material. Finally, it settles down on this leisurely idea. And this strangely sad yet cheerful goodbye. The second movement is solemn, quite serious, and at times really quite emotional. You could think of it almost as an ABA form, but there's a bit more to it than that. It starts with this idea. Immediately followed by this. What then follows is one of music's great consolations, as if telling you that though life can be hard, it'll all be all right. And that carries on beautifully. One of the extraordinary things about that tune, I think, is that it only appears twice. Brahms lets it speak for itself and decides that two appearances is enough to say all that it needs to say. No melody, the critics said. Another theme from this first section is this. As this first section continues, key changes become deeper, more solemn, and then we reach a lighter section, a B section perhaps. We change to 12/8 time with a graceful syncopated theme. That then flows into this idea. Surprisingly, this theme then starts developing in an increasingly agitated state, and after a climax of agitation, we return to our A section. The A section develops more, explores its ideas a little deeper, and with more variation. When we reach this idea, it is developed more climactically. Yet finally, things wind down, and the music dies away smoothly. The third movement is a scherzo. It is scored for a smaller orchestra, with no drums or brass, but three horns. It begins with a simple melody on the oboe, with luxurious pizzicato accompaniment in the cellos. Suddenly, the time changes to 2-4, with bars as short as the 3-4 bars. The theme changes also, but only on a surface level. Beneath the surface, it is actually, basically, the same theme. Then, our delightful theme is inverted, so that it can look like a new theme. Later, we return to 3-4 time, and the theme turns itself into a bass ostinato. This crescendos while the winds make loud comments in phrases of their own. Then, the winds take off with their own version of the inverted theme in 3-8 time. And the movement goes on like this, constantly developing and varying our main theme. Finally, it ends warmly, with this line in the strings, which is immediately imitated by the winds in free inversion. Clever Brahms. The finale has an even greater number of richly developed themes, but it doesn't need too much quotation. It's in sonata form, and this is the first theme. And so on. And this continues like so. The developments of this are quite easy to follow, though Brahms is of course endlessly inventive, as if he'll never run out of things to do with his themes. The second subject is this. Anyway, it goes on in a standard sonata form with a great development of his themes. One such development is this moment. The first subject has been inverted and sprinkled with many fragments of diminished inversions too. Anyway, after a lot of development, the main theme is transformed into a new idea. And then this. It has an atmosphere of tenderness and mystery, and it leads on to this. Hints of Beethoven's Fourth, anyone? Or Mahler's First, which is yet to be written? Anyway, so that's how the recapitulation returns. Not with climactic intensity, but a settling down, a mysterious sense of less is more. The recapitulation is regular, though Brahms humorously inverts the continuation of the main theme, with all its accompaniments. And the recapitulation continues as you'd expect. The coda begins in the minor, with a new version of the second subject in trombones. Then there's this amazing build-up, a combination of both the second subject, in basses, and that mysterious slower development theme up above. Then it's all worked up in excitement and climax, breathlessness and whirlwind, until it all ends on a wonderful fanfare, based around the second subject. Thank you, Brahms. If you want to find the top recommended recordings of this piece, or discover more of the best of Brahms, Primephonic is a great way to do so. It's a high-quality music streaming service with amazing resources for discovering more of the music you love. If you want to try Primephonic for 2 months free, you can visit the link in the description and use the voucher code INSIDETHESCORE. This will give you 2 months completely free, so you can decide if this service is right for you. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you soon.